And welcome to this big history project keynote, which will have a bit of a double introduction, because I will first introduce Constance van Hal and Joris Beulmeister from Roland Holst College in Hilversum, which is the pioneering high school in the Netherlands that is using big history project material in very innovative ways and also is using their own approach to actually spread the word about big history in the Netherlands. And they've been very successful in doing that. So they will actually introduce Bob Regan from the Big History Project.
As a teacher of history, you are used to get to wait when a new method is coming into the air. wait when everything is finished, and you have to work out very many things for yourself. So, when we from the time we're teaching big history, we're so glad we met. We met you.
Yeah, and we're pleased to announce Bob Regan. He's the director of education at BGC3. It's difficult to pronounce for us. It's from the Big History Project, and that's for high schools. And we owe you so much, Bob. We use a lot of the course materials, and you'll talk to you about that. And we're very fortunate to have him here. So thank you.
The big history word is spreading along the high schools in Holland, and it's so easy for us to say there's a website, it's always up to date, it's beautiful, and you can make use of it.
Okay,
so Bob.
We should give these two a round of applause for bringing all the students who've been guiding everyone around the event. Thank you, everybody. Yeah. Thanks to the organizers of the event for inviting us again this year. It's terrific. I think we're all really, really lucky to be here in Amsterdam. This is my first time, so I feel like I'm on a really special vacation. But Fred, Esther, David, Craig, thank you guys for putting on this kind of event and getting this kind of special thing going. As you may have noticed, I am not Andy Cook, who was supposed to come and speak, and there was some snafus, so here I am. My name's Bob. I am the guy who does a lot of the day-to-day work on the Big History Project, working with teachers, developing the curriculum, developing some of the newer assets that you see. I'm responsible for coordinating with David, coordinating with Bob Bain, and just kind of having my fingers in too many pots. But the most fun I have is working with teachers. So I was particularly thrilled I finally get to meet Constance in person instead of just over email or over the phone. So what I wanted to do today was just kind of go back and talk a little bit about the Big History Project. We started, it started 8 years ago when David met up with Bill Gates, who's my boss, and said, hey, let's turn this into a high school course. Now, the course has been running. We're in our fifth year, and it's been an incredible experience, and it's been incredible in so many ways. In terms of what we've learned about what a course like this can mean for kids, what it can mean for teachers, what we've learned about pulling a free curriculum together. You think about how much schools spend on textbook materials, how much they spend on professional development, and how they use technology. And what we've really also tried to do is really rethink a lot of those elements of what goes on. So the course was really special in a lot of ways. One of the first things that Bill described about the course when he took it, because he took David's great courses lectures, and he came out of that saying, wow, this is a framework for all knowledge. Everything hangs off of big history, which when I first started, I was like, well, gosh, that's a little grandiose. But I'll be damned if it didn't bear out in the research. And one of the things that we have found is that the course is having a very positive impact on students, and it's that impact is carrying forward in their years past taking the course. So it shapes the way that they think about their own futures and what they want to do. It shapes the way that they ask questions in later courses. What we hear from a lot of teachers when we interview them is they can always tell who the big history kids are, because they're going to be the ones going, why are we, this is not what we're hearing in chemistry. Why isn't the chemistry course being, why aren't we covering the same materials? So that sort of natural inclination to draw insights from one class to another, tearing down the walls of the curriculum, is something that these kids are taking on naturally, which is really one of the original goals, and it's carried forward. The course is free, right? And that's always great. Everyone's like, oh, I love free. But we always have to point out to people, it's not free like beer. You can't just drink it and go home. It's free like a puppy. You have to help us raise this thing, right? And, you know, that's one of the things about free that I think a lot of people miss, that a free curriculum isn't really free because it requires a lot of work on the part of the teachers. And for some of these teachers, it's more work. For a certain type of teacher, they're like, I've been teaching this way my whole life. But there are teachers out there who like to lecture, who like to know everything before they teach it to their kids, and they like showing a movie at the end of the term, and you know, and that for them is a great term. But if someone says, I want to do things differently, then we have an obligation to help them make that transition so that the way, the orientation, the philosophical orientation, the sort of the mindset that is represented in Big History, how do you go about changing your whole way of teaching? That's hard, and it's scary. And you know, it does require a lot of empathy on our part to help them do that. So free isn't always free, right? The course was designed as a concept car. You know, we wanted to make something that was really like cutting edge. And by cutting edge, it is so not cutting edge when you think about it from a technological standpoint. 55% of the classrooms that use the Big History website are used in classrooms where there's just a projector and one computer. The kids don't regularly have access to technology. As much as we all take it for granted, they don't. There's not one-to-one deployments of technology in many countries where we're deployed. So we have to devise something that works for situations where the kids can get to it all the time, and at the same time also works when the teacher has to print things out and hand out the papers. And so that's been part of our challenge in thinking through all that kind of stuff. But there's lots of little tiny experiments that we do all the time that we can afford to do. We can take risks that other people can't, so that if something goes wrong, then we can just tell everyone, yeah, we tried that, it was a terrible idea, we're not doing that again, please don't make the same mistake. Or if you do want to make the same mistake, just do it somehow differently so maybe someone else learns something. And we do this a lot. People will come to us and they'll say, we want to, the guys at Crash Course, we introduced some videos from John Green and Hank Green, and they came to us and said, we want to make our courses into like Big History style courses. And we're like, great, here's the recipe. Here's everything we did. You can steal anything you want, and if you do anything that's different, then tell us how it went so we can learn from you. And that kind of spirit of collaboration across museums, across other OER providers, and teachers has really been critical for us. So one of the things that we're most proud of is the program that surrounds the content. The content is derived from the great research that scholars like you are doing all the time, and we want to make sure that we're bringing that in. I think that at the same time, we want the teachers to be participating in that conversation. What can teachers be learning as they're working directly with kids so that they're sharing that knowledge, they're sharing your insights with the kids? How do we bring the kids closer to real academic research, to real scholarship, is one of the big things. But at the same time, we need to help teachers get ready to teach in this kind of way. I spent a lot of time working with schools that are interested in doing this, and I'll tell you, one of the most common things I hear from people is, I have a history major. I don't know anything about nuclear physics or, you know, Big Bang or fusion or any of that kind of stuff. And it's a really hard transition for teachers to make sometimes. That they can't be the font of all knowledge. They have to adopt the posture of learning alongside the kids, to be the lead learner in the classroom. And we remind them, we bring in some of the best scholars in the world to talk to your kids. You're just facilitating the conversation. So, but at the same time, what we have to do is really get those folks ready. So some of the things that we've done there is we just launched a new online course called Teaching Big History. It's about 10 hours long, and it goes through, like, the first thing they watch is David's TED Talk. So they start to get the story. We want that narrative going in their heads right away. But we also have a specific approach to reading that we promote in the course. Now, many people have other methods to teach reading, but frankly, a lot of history teachers don't recognize that they're also reading teachers. They're also writing teachers. And so we've tried to, you know, make some assumptions and embed them in the course. If they reject it, that's fine. But building that up, that program, has been really important. They'll learn about how we approach our research, and then we also push them into our online community. The BHP teacher community is probably one of the most important things that we do, because there's always questions that come up. There's always like, I don't know how this is really working. And sometimes, you know, when somebody says, this is a terrible activity, what they're really saying is, I don't know how to do it. And so we have a group of teacher leaders who will, you know, are trained to respond and kind of help coach people through these kinds of conversations. The thing that's unique, there's lots of online communities around teaching, but there are very few that are specifically tied to a curriculum where you can say, this lesson is troublesome. In this lesson, this is happening. Or I'm really not sure how to use that. When we do claim testing, what does he really mean by intuition? All of this stuff that is just loaded with jargon that's specific to our course has more meaning than it would in a broader online community. But it also means that there's always help. You can always go online and ask a question, and there will always be people there. Now, the clever teachers will occasionally do things like tag David in a question, and David has popped in there to say, all right, I'll answer that. And that's also been a big thing, that knowing that people respond. David, how many times would you say teachers have emailed you directly saying, would you talk to my kids?
Several times a year. five or six times a year.
And that's great. I would encourage the teachers I regularly encourage them to email all of the scholars. Email Craig. Email Cynthia. Email everyone who's involved in the course. We want to bridge that kind of thing. We want to bridge the scholars and the teachers, but also the teachers feeling like they have backup, that they have support, that there are people who genuinely care about what's going on in their classrooms makes a huge difference as they think about how they approach the work. What else did I want to say about this? So it's another thing that's been really important for us. We collect a lot of data. And you guys that teach the course, you know that we survey the heck out of you. You're getting a survey multiple times a year. You're doing writing samples. You're doing logs. And it just is happening all the time. And one of the things that we learned pretty early on is when we took the results of that data and we actually made changes to the course to reflect the survey data, the teacher's like, oh, that's actually really cool. You actually listen. You're not just surveying us. You're doing things with that. What we found is that moving forward, we got a lot higher submission rates from teachers. Because they know we're using the information, they took it more seriously. But that's not really the important thing. Because, you know, frankly, we can only change the course so many times before it becomes annoying. Like, it can be a frustration to teachers if you change it too often. But by getting people to really actively participate in our surveys, they're reflecting on their own practice. They're not just saying this is a good activity or this is a bad activity. They're asking themselves, how can I make this work better in my classroom? And at its root, at its core, professional development is nothing more than reflection. It's nothing more than thinking about what you're doing today and how you can do it better. So the more we can foster that, whether it's through our surveys, whether it's through our community, the better off we are. So this is one of the reasons why you'll always see us making updates and making changes, because if we don't, then we break down that process that has been really essential to helping our teachers get excited. Now, another thing that we do that I think it's just the least sexy thing that we do, but it's so essential. Teachers are, by and large, the ones who are adopting this course. We have lots of large districts. For example, in the United States, we now have about 10 districts that are adopting the course in a substantial way. We have we're going to end up with about 18 schools in New York City this year, which is really something. But those are hard, because when you get the district level, the local authority level administrators on board, then they're going around chasing teachers. It's a lot easier when a teacher says, I want to do it, and then you have to convince the people above. But they need help, right? And so this is where free has to borrow from what the salespeople at the textbook companies do. Because they have to, that when you are trying to adopt a course, you have to know, how does it meet the local standards? What hour of the day should it be in? You know, where is it going to fit? Is it going to replace this course or this course? Because in no country in the world is there an hour that was just sitting there waiting to be filled with a course. Something else has to go. And so we have to struggle through all of that. So we do a lot of work with teachers about helping them, you know, do these kinds of solicitations. The other thing that comes up are all of the natural concerns. You know, and this is perhaps a uniquely American problem, but as you may have heard, we have a lot of conservatives in our country, religious conservatives in particular. So we always have to talk them through the problem of, how can I teach this course with the Big Bang in it? So we're not very popular in Texas, for example, and frankly, I'm not going to bother trying. Yeah. Well, you know, I have some good friends in Texas. They just, their kids aren't going to take this course. But but that said, we are also very, very, we have done very well in some very conservative communities. We've actively sought out opportunities to partner with district level administrations in suburban Phoenix, which is crazy conservative, and up in rural Idaho, where you can start thinking about how can we position the course so that it's not threatening. And we've actually been quite successful in that. So in thinking about, for us, I think this has been like one of the topics here. What defines big history? When are you teaching big history and when are you teaching something else? We had to come up with a shorthand way of doing this, frankly, so we could decide whether or not you count as one of the schools that we're putting up here as a school. And so we started thinking about, are you teaching all of the thresholds, or are you only doing the last three or four? If you're only doing the last three or four, we consider you someone who's supplementing your course with big history. You're not teaching big history. Are you teaching origin stories? Are you teaching collective learning? If you're not doing those things, you're not really teaching big history as far as we're concerned. So if you answer those survey questions wrong, you're excluded from our numbers. You don't count. You're a supplementer. That's great. The other thing that's in this notion of skills, these are the things that we find actually that are carrying forward. And so we have our researchers looking for these, and are you seeing evidence of this 2 years later? So the notion of scale, thinking big, thinking small, thinking near, thinking far, thinking both, you know, across space and time, that's really been one of the key instruments in helping the kids develop better questions and in improving inquiry. It's by similarly, this notion of interdisciplinarity. One of the activities one of our teachers came up with, which is just genius. You come up with a scenario, and the kids have to assemble a CSI team, team of specialists, and they have to justify, why would you have this scholar on your team? What questions would that scholar ask? And the kids don't need to know the answer, but they need to start thinking about the questions. And then, you know, when you get into claim testing, and how much does this audience know about claim testing? So this is Bob Bain's work. And he would be here, but he's got a grandkid on the way momentarily. Is this your work?
My work.
Not Bob's. I'm sorry, David. I should have known. I'm an asshole. I'm sorry. So claim testing is a really, really powerful way for kids to just deal with new information. How does it jibe with your intuition? What's the authority that's presenting the claim? What's the evidence that they're presenting? And what's the authority, what's the logic of the argument? And so if you have these four things, we hammer on this. We introduce it early in the course, and we reinforce it in every single unit. So one of the teachers, when we first introduced claim testing, we did this whole activity with them to explain what claim testing is. And they go, God, it's going to take them a long time to really understand this. And I'm like, yep, it's going to take all year. But once they get it, this is another one of those things that absolutely is staying with these kids 2 years and more later, because it's so easy. So at first, we use this as a way to just govern academic talk in the classroom. So rather than just saying, you're wrong, we want the kids to use the language of claim testing. Now, wait. Where's the evidence? What's the authority of that evidence? We want them to start developing that. We have them use that in their approach to reading, when they're going through a challenging text and looking for these elements in the construction of the reading. And then finally, in the writing. We want them to be really thinking carefully about this, even to the point you think about intuition. And one of the things that we try to talk to teachers about is that, you know, kids eventually need to think about their audience. Who are they writing for? What background knowledge are the writers or the readers going to be bringing, and how can you actually address and fill in any gaps in the background knowledge they might be maybe bringing there? Reading and writing has been essential to the course. We hit these bumps right away. Like you said to me, you know, like right before, like, this is a hard course for ninth graders, and it is a hard course for 14-year-olds. It's a very challenging course. What we found early on is that some of the teachers were revising the material to make it easier for their kids. And that led us in some interesting directions about what we call leveling the text, writing multiple versions at different levels. But in particular, what we were struck by is this gap that history teachers really weren't thinking or feeling like it was their responsibility to teach reading or writing. So we had to build in some more supports for that. And that's been, it's been one of the most well-received things that we've done. So let's talk a little bit about how big we're getting. You can see we're about 1 month away from wrapping up this school year. We're probably going to go up about another 100 by the time we close out, because this is where we get a lot of the Australian schools will finally kick in, because it takes a certain amount of time before you have to use the course for 3 months before we count you. And then you have to get through the survey questions, and there's all kinds of things that we do to try and make sure we're only counting schools and not just some guy in a basement who likes the site a lot. We have some schools that we keep very close to us. We call them design partners. These are the folks that we have formal arrangements with. And those groups are really important, because they really give us the most information. They know us personally. They have my cell phone number. They use it. But it's important that we have that kind of availability, because that's how we really know what's going on the ground. The other folks, the people who just come to the website and just sign up and start teaching it, we refer to those folks as at large. Now, our goal is to get to over 2,000 in the U.S. and over 3,500 worldwide by 2020. And so we track this stuff pretty carefully on a monthly basis. Now, one of the things that's important to keep in mind is that those folks are teaching it as a course for at least a semester. It's its own course. We have over 50,000 people that have registered for the site, and probably about 20,000 of them are using the site in some way. They're teaching some other history class, and they're just borrowing pieces of it. And that's great. We don't count that. That's not in this list. And we don't actually even do that much to support those folks, but we have that kind of reach, which has been really, you know, we're pleased, but we don't count it. But if you think about the number of students and the number of people that we're hitting every year, we're thrilled with that. And one of the things to keep in mind is that in the office, there's three of us now that are full time. Up until recently, there were only two of us that are really interfacing with teachers. And in a textbook company, on other projects I've worked in, you'd have 150 people doing what we're doing with just a handful of people. So now we do have the benefit of a lot of help from folks that aren't necessarily full-time, but who are really important. So here's some, everyone loves a good chart full of numbers, right? But let me show you some stuff here that I think is kind of important. When course satisfaction, we surveyed the teachers first time in 2014, and we said, okay, how many of you are satisfied with the course? 83% of the people said, thumbs up, I'm satisfied. And I remember saying to Bill and to Andy, well, you know, brace yourself, because there's nowhere to go but down from here. And it hasn't happened yet. So what you see is in the following year, we went up to 94%, and we just wrapped this year with a 94% satisfaction rating from our design partners, which is really something we're very proud of. The willingness to recommend has also maintained a really, really high percentage rate. And if you look at this, nearly 90% of the 90% of the teachers say that this course is going to help prepare kids for the future, that these skills and this mindset that they're developing is going to help out. Now, we did a quick survey in the U.S. because we wanted to see, how does that compare to other courses? Is that good? Are we just deluding ourselves into thinking it's good? And so this row gives, this column gives you some sense of how other teachers think about other history courses. So it just gives us a quick little comparison. But what I didn't put on here is the one I probably should. The number I'm, one of my favorite statistics is that 86% of the teachers who teach this course say that it's changed their teaching. That they are fundamentally approaching their instruction in a different way. And that's really, that's something that for me, I'm particularly proud of. Now, another thing that we do is we collect writing samples. In partnership with the University of Michigan, we collect writing three times, the beginning of the year, midpoint, and end of the year. And to give you a sense of what this means, this is, for ninth grade, this is the 10th grade level. Not all these kids are in 10th grade. Some of these kids are younger than that, some of them are older, but on average, they're about 14 years old. If you're red at the beginning of the year, that means you're more than 2 years behind grade level. And so what you see then is we've gotten really good improvement, moving, you know, nearly half the kids down here more than 2 years behind to 40% being above grade level, which is, you know, this is remarkable. One thing that's really important to keep in mind, this population represents 45% of them are what we call Title I schools in the U.S. This means these are high poverty schools where 70% of the kids are qualifying for free lunches in the United States. So a lot of one of the first reactions you often get from people is that this course is too hard for 14-year-olds. And we've proven that's not the case. It's also, you can expect as much from kids in low tech and underserved communities. You can expect as much from these children as you expect from children in some of the more well provided for schools. And you can get dramatic results And that's, I'm going to spare you that chart because that's an eye chart, but it carries over across demographics and across populations in a way that's really powerful. Speaking of eye charts, this gives you a little bit more of a breakdown in terms of, you know, looking at student reasoning and the gains that we're seeing there, their use of evidence, and in writing mechanics. And you can see that we don't get the same dramatic gains in writing mechanics. They pop up pretty quickly. But in your use of evidence and reasoning, these are the disciplinary skills of history that a lot of our history teachers were not focusing on right away. So this is one of the areas where we're seeing the biggest gains. Now, talked about this a little bit. We've for the last 2 years, we've sent academics, researchers from the learning in informal and formal environments, the Life Institute at the University of Washington, and we've sent them into classrooms of kids that took the course 2 years ago. We wanted to find out, is this making a difference? And it is. What we found is that the kids 2 years later, they can name all the thresholds and they can tell you the story of the thresholds. It stays with them. It speaks to the level of engagement of the material. All of the other gains that we see come from the fact that they actually like the class. If they didn't, they wouldn't do all of the hard work. Just to go back to the writing gains for a second, that's not BHP specific. If you really clearly articulate what is good writing, and you give kids regular opportunities to write and regular feedback, they're going to get better. I don't care what class you're in. But if the kids hate the class, they're not going to do the work. So when you have this kind of engagement where the kids are diving into the material and it's sticking with them 2 years later, you have an opportunity to develop basic skills in a way that other classes won't present. So the other thing that we found is that a lot depends on the teacher. It really does. If the teachers who do best are the ones who say, guys, we're in this together. I don't know all of this stuff, but when we don't know, we're going to work through this together. Those are the teachers who are spoken of most fondly 2 years later. The teachers who don't do well are the ones who are struggling with the material and they're still trying to lecture. That's something that, you know, again, there's a wealth of research that bears this out, but it's particularly important in a class like this where, you know, 13.8 billion years and 12 different disciplines are mentioned in our course alone. That's ignoring all of the other disciplines and everything else the kids are bringing in. So there's no way to stay on top of all of this. We are finding that kids are using the course as a way to make sense of everything else, as I mentioned earlier. They're using the thresholds to try and connect things. They're looking to other classes to try and tie things together. And it is helping them in their courses down the road. Now that the kids are reporting that, we don't have the data from a quantitative standpoint to back that up, but the kids are reporting that they're still using it. But the other thing that's important is that the kids are reporting that this course is changing their decisions about their future. In the simplest way of thinking about it, if you can get through big history in your ninth grade year as a 14-year-old, you're willing to take those harder courses in your as an upperclassman. You know you're ready for them. And in fact, a lot of teachers are telling us that this course is better for preparing kids for more challenging university-level courses down the road than some of the classes that were specifically designed to do that. The other thing that we're hearing from kids is that they're making career decisions. They're making life decisions based on this course. They're deciding, I want to be an astrophysicist. I want to be an anthropologist, which is really great. And I have to share this with you guys. This is brand new. This is just total hokum. But this came in from a teacher the other day. And this is a kid who was relatively quiet all year. And at the end of the year, the kid came in with this letter and just handed it to the teacher and basically just ran out. And so, you know, this idea, this To me, this isn't just a history class, but something that has given me so much more. The structure of this curriculum has completely changed the way I look at the world. The lens that this course uses to understand the universe has been very enlightening and inspired me to share my own way of looking at things. Concepts such as scale and networks between people have helped me understand my own relationship with the world around me. So there's a bunch more in there, but like that's pretty amazing to come from a ninth grader. And I think that this is not a teacher. This has been a journey for the teacher as well. So for the teacher to get validation like this by taking this kind of risk and putting in the work, I think that this is the ultimate kind of success story that we're trying to achieve. And it's rare that you're going to have content which would create this kind of situation. So, what else did I want to talk about? I want to talk about, at this point, now we're kind of like, all right, what's next? What do we need to do that's better? How do we keep improving? How do we keep making things better? Where can we have more of an impact? We want to do more for kids. We want those writing scores to be even better, and we think we can make them better. I'm going to show you one of our approaches to that in a second. We need to be thinking about tools to help kids deal with video. This is another thing that I think is really, really important. One of the things that we noticed early on was that teachers, like when we released Crash Course, has anyone ever seen our Crash Course videos on the site? One thing you'll notice is that John Green, who is, if you are a person of a certain age, he is super famous and loved, and for many, many good reasons. To some of us, he sounds like Jackie Stewart announcing Formula One racing. You know, that old sports announcer, he sounded like he was on amphetamines. It was just so fast, there was no way to do it. So the teachers are saying, I can't understand what John Green is saying. It's too fast. The kids think he's too fast. How about, there's students back there. Is he too fast? Yeah, something like that. So my response to the teachers was like, well, how many times are you watching these videos? I was like, well, once. You're like, well, there's your problem right there. You don't read anything once. You know, we talk a lot. At this point, we are already talking about three close reads of like the hardest readings. When you're reading that Darwin text in the course, we really want you to go through it a few times. And this is what you do when you're really dealing with something tough. But we don't talk about that with video. We don't treat video as text. And so how can we build tools to help make that easier? And so we did some experiments there. But even though kids don't often have laptops, they all have this. Even in some of the poorest communities, they've got one of these. So what does this experience look like for reading video? Not just passively consuming video, actively reading video. What is some of the tooling that we can do there? Training teachers. Teacher professional development remains one of the most thorny challenges in all of education. And we have that problem. It's not just our problem, but it's definitely our problem. You have one of the hardest classes that's offered out there because you can go deep into any subject possible. And so how do we help people get ready for that kind of thing? And so we're doing some new experiments there. And then we have to find a way, and it really, I talk about this a lot with Bob Bain, usually over Scotch, that we're just not sharing enough. We're not writing enough. I'm spending too much time writing lessons and not enough time writing so that other people can steal our examples and borrow from what we're doing. Because the more we can collaborate and really flesh this kind of stuff out, the better that we are. There's a lot of free curriculum out there. And it's rarely used because it's rarely good. And so how do we make free curriculum better so we can truly replace textbooks and really rethink the role of the textbook in the school? So one of the first things that we did, going back to the writing, oftentimes when we do this writing study, the teachers will ask, can I have the scores for my kids? And the answer is no, you can't have the scores because it's a study, which means it's anonymous, which means no, you can't have your kids' scores back. And it seemed like a heck of a missed opportunity. So we said, well, what if we just hired a bunch of graduate students and we just made it a service? So that's what we're doing. Working together with Michigan, we've got a bunch of graduate students at Arizona State, and we are going to grade essays for free. If you want, we'll grade your students. And the premise being, we're not trying to replace the teacher, we're trying to supplement the teacher. I have a hard job, but I have such an easy job compared to when I was in the classroom. It takes, on average, we estimate about 10 hours to grade essays from one classroom full of kids. So you don't have more time to grade more essays. And so what we wanted to do was to give kids more feedback, and that's one of the ways that we're going to push. So the way this is going to work is we're going to, just using the exact same method within the website, kids will submit essays. When you have enough of them, you just press go. And that will send it to Arizona, and there'll be grad students sitting there at the ready, and they should get them back to you pretty quickly. We're only promising it'll be a 2-week turnaround, but we know it needs to be a day or two in order for it to be useful. So we're working on that. But frankly, this is an experiment. We don't know of anyone that's ever tried this. And one of the things that we're doing in the background is we're also going to use machine scoring, which everyone should be going right now like, ew, how can you do that? That's terrible. But the thing about machine scoring is it gives us a way, when you machine score, you're also comparing the human scores. So we'll know when a human has kind of gone off the rails. Because, I mean, let's face it, they're graduate students, you know. One rough night and like the scores could go haywire. So the machine scoring can really help us track when things go a little bit sideways and still keep the cost down. So we're going to be experimenting with this. This is going to roll out probably in about 2 weeks and we'll be ready. But you're already, if you look in the website, you're already going to see that you can enroll. This is a big, big experiment. The other thing that we did, and you know, we did a teaching course 2 years ago, and it was awful. It was just terrible, and it's all my fault. I wrote all of the scripts, and I hired a terrible producer to do it. And I was trying to save money, and it was awful. So I killed it all, and we rewrote it, and sat down with Bob Bain, and we really tried to look at like what are the things that you need to know before you go in and teach your first big history class? We still do. In fact, I have to leave on Sunday so I can get back and do the first one of these in Ann Arbor. We do these trainings for new teachers. Last year, we did 17 of them. And let's just say that my wife threatened severe bodily harm if I were to attempt to do that much travel again this summer. And here I am in Amsterdam. Yeah, she's at grandma and grandpa, so everyone's happy. But the point is that we were growing so big that in order to serve the same number, to provide the same level of service, we would have had to have done 30 different cities this year. And there was just no way. There was just no way. So we needed to start moving some of this stuff online so we could scale. And driving people, the unique element of this is it's not just a bunch of videos. For all of the videos, we asked teachers to write posts that talk about, okay, here's how it really works in my classroom. And then we push everyone into an online community to have a conversation about it. So we're going to see how this goes. So far, we've only been promoting this for 2 weeks. We already have about 750 people that have started the course. 250 people have finished it. But if you finish it, we want you to keep going. So we're going to give everyone $25 who finishes it to go to Amazon so they can buy a book. You know, like, go read This Fleeting World. Go read. Go do something more because this is not enough. But we're going to see how this goes. And what was really great is we were able to bring all of our teachers to Seattle. And you know, the teachers contributed heavily to the scripts. We did... This time, we used a comedy writer as well to try and make sure that it didn't sound as boring as the last one. And we were able to bring teachers from Australia, teachers from New York, and just everyone. And so it feels a little bit more like our larger community. I want to talk a little bit more about some of our content here and some of the other things that we've done. So first of all, this is a little bit unusual. I talked about how hard the readings are for some of our kids. And we had a woman in Iowa who was teaching a lot of Hmong children. So if you commute from like Thailand or Vietnam, you're probably gonna be moved to either Minneapolis, Madison, Wisconsin, or suburban Des Moines, Iowa. And so really amazing Thai food. But it actually, because there's such a large population there, you kind of maintain some continuity for a lot of these kids. But English is their second language. So she was rewriting everything and said, well, that's nuts. So we hired an editing team from a group called Newzella, and they, by hand, edited every single text in the course. So there's at least three versions, sometimes four, sometimes five versions. And the idea was that if you're teaching 14-year-olds, you should be able to support someone who's 2 years behind in their reading. And they should be able to sit in a room and have the same conversation, that their skill in reading does not reflect their skill and comprehension of the big ideas. And so we can give them time to push up. This has been an incredibly powerful tool, especially among some of the more underfunded schools that we've been working with. Now we added another tool this year, and it's not actually on the slide. We teamed with another group because everyone hated our vocabulary. Vocabulary was consistently one of the areas where we were just doing a terrible job. At least that's what the teachers told us. So what we did is we worked with a group called Text Genome, and they scanned in all of our articles, all of our video transcripts, and they spat out a vocabulary. And so it turns out, in looking at like some of our earlier articles, we would have focused on words like supernova or Cepheid star. And they were coming back saying, you know, the word appropriate is a very good vocabulary word for a 14-year-old. You probably should have that in there. And that forced us, at that point, then we said, okay, now maybe Cepheid star can go away, but we're going to keep supernova and we'll use the word appropriate. And we have more of a broader approach to vocabulary. What Text Genome does, which is very different, is the definitions are removed for the kids. They focus instead on the examples and learning the word from context, using semantic networks, and using word families. And so it's a very, very different kind of approach. We have definitions. They're in the glossary. They're still there. We didn't totally eviscerate them. But we worked with a researcher from UC Santa Cruz who's been doing a lot of work on the neuroscience behind how we come to learn words. And so that's another one of our big content improvements this year. So we're going to see how that goes. We also added some new science content. We wanted to add lessons that gave people a chance to go a little bit deeper on some of the concepts. We had some teachers that were interested in doing that. They're meant to be to help increase the interest in the science and make things a little bit more engaging. It still doesn't turn it into a science class, but it helps illuminate some more of the complicated ideas that exist in the course. So, for example, you know, we talk a lot about accretion and how planets all come together. So we'll literally have kids take balloons and start throwing them at one another and seeing if they can create a planet out of it. So I want to take a minute and just talk about our friends at Macquarie. We can't do what we do without them. We remain strong partners across serving the U.S. And Australia. We're working on new pathways going forward so that we can scale even bigger. Macquarie is very interested in and is developing plans around supporting the Big History Project in other languages. There is no more effective advocate for Big History as a discipline than David Christian. And they remain a center of excellence in terms of the research and the scholarship. The Big History Project is really, we're focused on the curriculum that we have, the English language curriculum that we have and the way that it's used. We do all the things I just described, and we're going to continue to do so, and we're going to continue to do so in coordination with our friends at Macquarie. He's taking a picture of that one, all right? Okay. So, we're gonna, how am I doing on time? When am I supposed to be done? Huh? Oh, I'm not going to make, this is not, we're done soon, don't worry. Okay. No, because like cocktails are going to be ready soon, right?
Soon, yeah.
Okay, all right, so we want to get big, we want to get bigger. Some of the big things, we haven't set our plans for next year, but let me tell you about some of the things that we're thinking about. I want a better, bigger, broader online community. Our current online community is separate. It's based on a platform called Yammer. But it's a little bit too far away. I'd love it in Facebook. I'd love it in LinkedIn. I'd love it in something that teachers are already in. And how do we create something that's a little bit closer? There are huge problems with using both of those tools. But the problem remains the same. How do you make something that, how do we make professional development something that happens all the time? Sometimes actively, sometimes stealthily. And, you know, and a lot, if you don't follow us on Facebook, you should, because that's where a lot of the stealth stuff happens. We just find cool things, and literally it'll come down to, hey, this is kind of a cool little post that somebody did, like, let's throw it up. When Juno reached Jupiter, right away, we're like, all right, find something, let's get stuff up. We call Cameron Gibaloo at University of Michigan, said, Cameron, what you got, buddy? And we just throw it out there. And frequently, and I'm saying this to the students in the back, when something cool happens, we want the students to write, why do I care? So what? And when a student says, this is why you should care about what just happened with Pluto, like, those are amazing posts. We had a post, by the way, again, Esther, you invented the little big history, right?
Together with John.
Awesome. Right, and so the Little Big History Project is where a kid, for those of you that don't know, at the end of the Big History course, the kids have to choose an idea or an object that they care about, and they have to tell the history of it through at least three thresholds and using at least three disciplines. And you see these wonderful stories that come out. Some of my favorites I've seen are the history of flight, the history of sunglasses. We've seen the history of the Communist Party in North Korea. And one of the ones that we published over the weekend was a little big history of Hawaiian pizza. And oh my goodness, that lit up social media, let me tell you. And we can tell right away, we know if this you know, more than the stuff that we did on Juno, it was that student story on Hawaiian pizza that really took off. We need to change the student experience. We need to make it less like a textbook, but I don't know if we're really gonna tackle that problem because that means a complete overhaul of all of the content. And if I have to edit some of those lessons one more time, I might just jab a pencil in my eye. Okay, so that's what I wanted to tell you today. What do you wanna know? Questions? In the back.
So you mentioned the United States and Australia repeatedly.
Yes.
And I was wondering about your plans, first of all, for the Anglo-American world. I didn't hear about Britain, Canada, South Africa, African.
Go ahead, sorry.
I want to hear more about translating this better language.
That's a good question that we're not ready to answer yet. Is that fair to say, David? Yeah. So, in the course isn't geographically bound. I think, and it is almost always driven by teachers. One of the things I always tell people is I don't go where I'm not invited, right? And so, And that served me really well, because I was invited to an event in Florida, and somebody raised their hand and they said, how are you going to make this work with the Florida state standards, which are awful, just terrible standards? And I said, I don't know. That's actually not my problem. You invited me here. I'm here to help you map it into the standards. I'm not here to do it for you. But what we see is that people will pull it into where it suits them, which again is why the work that the teachers here in Amsterdam are doing is so remarkable, because this is an English language course that's being used in English here in a non-English speaking country, although everyone here seems to speak English beautifully. But it's, we'll let things go like that as we may. We do have a lot of adoptions in Canada. It hasn't been too much problem there. The UK is a little trickier, because the number one challenge we have is to find that hour in the day. And the UK curriculum is pretty thoroughly scripted. With the conservatives in power right now in the UK, there's just, like, they want people, they'd rather kids learn about the English Empire without all the critiques of the English Empire right now than introducing new curriculum like Big History. So we've struggled a little bit getting in there. We've had some luck with the IB. We've been teaming up with them and mapping Big History into the IB curriculum, and that's helped us open up some doors in places that otherwise it would have been hard. Yeah?
I just arrived, so this may have already come up, but my question, and you may not even be the right person to ask, what is the progress of Big History at the college level?
I don't know that we have statistics. That's a David and IBHA question more than a Big History Project question. So the question was, how many universities are teaching the course? What's the progress with universities? Yeah. I mean, and you know, the thing is, with the way that it's taught in the university, you don't have a single website and a single curriculum, you know, and the advantage for us is that we can capture all of the web data, so we can generate some data off of that. At the university level, I mean, we can look at the numbers of David's book or Cynthia's book or Craig's book.
There is a textbook.
I know. How many colleges ordered?
I have to stop thinking.
Okay.
Yeah. Mike.
I have a question on the essay.
Yeah.
Fantastic. What type of feedback are the students getting? Are they getting content-specific feedback? Are they getting mechanics-specific feedback?
They're getting numbers. They're getting numbers against a rubric. That's all they're getting. Arizona State really, really wants to provide comments, and we're a little bit worried that if they spend too much time writing up comments, that we won't be able to handle the volume that we need to handle. So we're looking at creating a predefined list of comments and providing that. But it's, you know, this is a formative assessment. It's just going to be really, really light. And then the thought is, in talking to a lot of the teachers who helped us plan this, is that the teachers would follow up and they would grade the second draft. So it gives you a starting point to work with the kids to respond to. Oh yeah, and in fact, it's the same rubric that we've been using, and we asked Bob Bain, because we're using the same methodology to score that we've been using for the study. So we asked Bob Bain to create a bunch of samples, and then we could say, this is a 1, this is a 2, this is a 3, this is a 4. And we originally wrote that so we could train the scores at ASU, but then we thought, well, that's going to be really good for the teachers. And then we thought, oh, heck, that's going to be great for the kids. So we'll be publishing that and putting it into the lessons. Yeah?
Can you give us a sense of the scale of the operation that you have? How many people you have working on content development?
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good question. The budget's actually pretty lean. We've deliberately tried to keep the budget something that could be replicated within a nonprofit environment. So grab a beer and come talk to me and I'll tell you the numbers. But so full time, we have myself, a community manager, and for the first time, just in the last month, we've added someone to go out and talk to schools and go out and recruit. And it's really not so much recruitment. We don't need help recruiting. What we need help are, like, once someone says they want to do it, going through the process of helping them get it locked down. Standards alignment, all that work. Chris Stussy, by the way, who's taking that job. So, and it's just going to be for a year. So that's great. We have a part-time engineering lead. She looks after, she's about half-time with us and half-time with other stuff in our office. Half-time marketing program manager. We have two half-time people, so like one graphics person, because like we're constantly creating graphics. It's one thing about us is we're very, very visually rich. And we always think, boy, we could probably save money if we weren't so pretty. But you know what? It definitely shapes people's reaction to us. We have, in terms of writers, I have a couple of go-to people for writers. One is the comedy writer. He used to work for The Office, and then he went to go teach in Oakland, California. And now I just throw stuff to him all the time. I think he's probably, depending on the time of year, when we're actively writing content, he can be about half time. And then I have a copy editor who works about a quarter time. And that's kind of it. Who am I missing? Then, you know, when we're in a big push, when we're doing a lot of stuff, then I'll bring on stringers. We do a lot, we ask teachers to write a lot for us. And I love teachers, and I think I've established that, but they're not all good writers. They're really not all good writers. So I tend to hire about double the number of writers that I need, and then when I see really quickly that they're not doing well, I say, oh, this is awesome, thank you, we got it from here. And we throw their stuff out. But the other thing is that, you know, In a professional publishing environment, no one's work goes direct up to the web. There's always a developmental editor who will kind of, you know, there's always two people who team up. There's always a copy editor. There's always a layout person. So when, even though we're hiring teachers, we want them to look amazing. We really want to celebrate everything they do. So we do that with our blog posts. Our social media posts, everything goes through a few different people. Usually it's me and the writers that I keep around. David.
I probably shouldn't ask a question, but it's about when we might start having a conversation that we're eventually going to have with educational authorities. So far, all schools have done this kind of voluntarily, not through the system. So my question is, do you have any feeling for when we might end up having conversations with educational authorities at the state level, presumably, about the possibility of big history becoming a more formal part of syllabi?
We are having those conversations. Typically at the local authority level, as opposed to the state authorities. It depends on the state, right? In the UK, you really have to do a national kind of initiative. In the US, we have a lot more luck at the district level. So the New York City Department of Ed, Chicago Public Schools, Miami, and Las Vegas are all pilots. And so we have really good conversations there. You have a very different set of problems when you're going top down as opposed to bottom up, because then, you have, I like to refer to the difference between volunteers and draftees. Draftees have a lot of opportunities to sabotage a course. So you really need to make sure that you've got the first schools to be teaching it in a new area. You really need them to be successful, which means you need people that are going to be in love with it. And then you find a way to scale it. Eventually, you're going to have to deal with the draftees. And that's a really hard thing. We do a lot of standards work, and so we are approved in the state of California as a course, so which means that it can count towards admission to the university. We're approved in New South Wales. We are endorsed by the International Baccalaureate, and these were all things that took a little while. And so you know, and the more that the further we get, the more established we get, the more often that we're going to have to do that. And it is going to be it's just hand-to-hand combat. There's no quick way for us to deal with that. Chris, the new engagement manager, I've asked him to kind of help us drive a lot of that work, because some of it's just gory, awful, boring stuff. And the thing about it, and I'll say this just one more thing about it, standards are just a fancy way of saying no. No one actually gives a shit about standards. They only use it as a way to obfuscate or to just to tell you to get lost. It's rare that I find someone who enthusiastically says, oh, we can do standards. It just doesn't happen. Any other questions? Yeah. That's a good question. You know, I think that every year we commit to another 7 years of supporting the course, right? And frankly, the course is only, this is one of the questions that people have, is they say, okay, it's free now, but are you gonna start charging money in 5 years? Like suddenly we're gonna fall in love with this thing and you're gonna start asking us for a bunch of cash? And we're like, no, one of the few times where you say, no, we're supported by Bill Gates. He's not going to run out of money. So we're going to be free forever. It won't live in Bill's office forever. And so that's the transition, sort of figure out, like, what happens to the course long term? We don't know the answer to that, because frankly, we're having so much fun with all these experiments that we're going to keep going. We're going through that process now and thinking about what are the other education initiatives out of the office that we're going to do. You know, can we take the big history engine and create other courses or, you know, whatever? We just don't know. We support another project called Graphite that is really focused on helping teachers understand good uses of educational technology. That's the other thing that I do on Wednesdays. That's my Wednesday job. The other 6 days of the week are this. So the way that we get there, we have reviews with Bill twice a year, and we spend about 6 weeks leading into each of those reviews, and strategy is always one of those things. We've tried to be measured in terms of our growth with respect to staffing and budget so that we don't overtake the office. I can't have 150 people in that space. It's too big, it's not appropriate. So we're careful there. And then in terms of our growth targets and how we get to the 2020 target, you know, a lot of it is based on social media and building that teacher community. Because we cannot build a sales force. And frankly, I don't think that's gonna be the way of the future for free curriculum. So I kind of dodged the second half of that 10-year question, but the first half, I think. Is that okay? Yeah. All right. So, and I'm going to end with Deb.
Me?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
This morning, I had the chance to give a talk about what I think about Bill's history.
Okay. How'd we do? I didn't get to see it. I only landed this morning. Yeah, I mean,
can you bring that across, and would Bill Gates like that? You know?
He does like that. He's not afraid of that. So the question is, you know, big history is very, very controversial. And, you know, it challenges the established worldview. What do we do around that? And we have to be careful with this. This actually, there's a guy named Jonathan Kozol who wrote Savage Inequalities, and this is like the first book I read that made me want to be a teacher. But my favorite book in education is a book he wrote called On Being a Teacher. And it was all about how you could introduce controversial ideas into a classroom without getting fired. And so he would say, like, you know, and this is a very US specific kind of thing, he was like, never teach Malcolm X. They can fire you for teaching Malcolm X. There's plenty of good stuff with Martin Luther King, and you will never be fired for teaching Martin Luther King. Really, really tactical stuff like that. In with our teachers, we have to warn them, like, you should know your audience. When you're going to present this course to your leadership, you should know what you're in for. And if it's going to be tough, if it's really, really going to be tough, call us. Because they can get mad at us and not fire you. You know, Bob Bain is really, in particular, when it's really horrible, Bob Bain is among the best at dealing with super conservative organizations. We have had two situations where teachers have been fired over Big History. One where somebody went in unprepared, didn't tell us, went to their board, and just they just blasted her. And she got shifted around, and you know, she wasn't fired, but she was no longer teaching at the same level, and she was definitely put on the back bench, so to speak. That situation is slowly but surely ameliorating, and we've tried to help her through that. We had another situation, and this is a totally different thing. It isn't related to the controversial nature of it. But we had teachers get into a fight over Big History. And this was really, it's a weird situation. You had the social studies person who was super excited about it, and then you had the curriculum person who was her boss who was also really excited about it. But there was this one arcane rule in that district that about what kind of credit it would count towards. I can't even remember what it was. It wasn't anything substantive, but they got into a fight. And next thing I know, they both got fired, like straight up fired for and what's the reason why that's relevant is then all of a sudden we've done all this work to get this set up. This is San Diego Unified School District. It's a big school district, 16 high schools. And the two people who are supposed to be our champions helping us lead this effort are gone, and we've got to rebuild the whole thing from scratch. Now, when we're working with individual teachers and we talk to them about how to position the Big Bang, I mean, this is the course does such a good job of presenting the notion of origin stories that we simply play that out. You play that out with everyone. We don't expect people to agree and accept everything that's in the course. However, in a civilized society, we do expect you to be able to thoughtfully, respectfully engage with this origin story. And so that's what we want your kids to be able to do. And occasionally people are like, yeah, right, you're trying to convert my kid. But, you know, that's as good as we can do. Deb. Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
And a few other schools, what would you say, you've alluded to several challenges, and
yeah.
I was just going to ask, you know, if people are considering taking on the course at the secondary school level, what are some of the challenges that are difficult to
overcome based on your attrition status? So this is interesting, and, you know, in any given year, yeah, the question is, what are the key challenges that drive that teachers face when they're adopting the course? And you know, and you alluded to the fact that we lose a fair number of schools every single year. Of the schools, only 2/3 of our schools return year over year. We lose people all the time. And when we first saw that, we freaked out. We were panicked. We're like, oh my God, the course is terrible and no one's telling us. And that's not it. So we surveyed a bunch of people that left, and it turns out that wasn't the case at all. In the United States, the average tenure of a teacher is about 5 years. And so if you think about the fact that no one allows teachers to make any decisions for the first 2 years, you've got about a 3-year window where you actually can reach these people. And because we're relying so heavily on teachers to promote the course, when a teacher leaves the building, the course goes with them. There's no one else who's saying, oh, I'm going to pick this up. Scotland's a good example of that. You know, the administrator who was really the driver there left, and no one else really picked it up after that. And that's a big challenge. That actually is one of the big challenges. If a teacher's going to do this, you always want to make sure that you have the support of your principal, but more importantly, whoever is responsible for the calendar, that's the person that can mess you up badly. Because you can get everyone on board, and if you don't have the person responsible for the calendar on board, you will turn up in the fall and find out that your course is not actually on the schedule. And say, oh, sorry, it just didn't work, which is horseshit. But that's what happens. You have to address that. So the other kinds of things that that teachers really struggle with is pacing. You know, a lot of teachers, especially teachers that are not super confident with the material, can get overwhelmed. And so that's why the community is so important, because that becomes our early warning system. We'll sort of ping these folks that are new. We want, if someone's in over their head and they're struggling, we want to hear about it early, so we have a chance to try and help them and talk them off the ledge, really just sort of calm them down a little bit. If possible, send one of our teacher leaders over to the building to show them, to just sort of either do a model lesson or observe them and give them some feedback. Try and do on-site coaching whenever we can. That's something that we really have to watch out for. We've had some ugly situations with parents. We had the most conservative community we dealt with was suburban Seattle, was up in Everett, that mega church up there. Those parents told the teacher that the kids were to be out of the room whenever the words evolution or the Big Bang were mentioned. So then those little turds of children set a trap for the teacher, and they asked a question that they knew was going to need to be answered using evolution or Big Bang. So then they went home and told their parents, teacher said evolution, Big Bang when I was in the room today. And so next thing you know, parents are in the principal's office, and fortunately she had a really supportive principal. And fortunately the pastor of that particular mega church was busted with a 16-year-old and pilfering from the collection box. So that church is gone. And things have gotten a lot better. So that's really hard, because that puts the teacher in a really, really tough spot. And you really have to wonder, like, I don't want any of these teachers to be fired. Like, you can only expose yourself so much. You need a strong community behind you in order to have good teaching. Someone once told me, one of my favorite professors once told me, that good teaching is messy. It's emotional, it gets crazy sometimes. And if you aren't prepared to have those kinds of conversations, then this is going to be a hard course. Last one, yeah. The question is, what culture is most receptive? I can't answer that. I mean, I think right now, English-speaking countries are most receptive, and people that just have perfect English, even though they're not an English-speaking country. It really comes down to mindset. It really does. There are schools for whom that they will tell us, oh my God, I've always wanted to teach this way. I can't believe we finally have a curriculum that reflects what we want to do. And I would say, like, haven't you guys ever heard of IB? We're not that new, but I think that schools that are open to the interdisciplinary nature of the course, I think that's a requirement in order for it to work. I think that one of the deliberate reasons why Bill got behind this course, I think one of the deliberate things that we hear from David a lot, is that insights come from all of the different disciplines, and too many of our schools try to create silos where one class doesn't talk to another class. You know, there's no continuity from course to course. So if you're not prepared for that, then that's where we run into trouble. And oftentimes, big history is seen as a tonic for that. As teachers are trying to bring something in, big history tends to be a pretty easy thing to bring in without completely overhauling your entire school program. Because we provide a lot of support for the teachers in making that kind of shift. Okay, so two things. Deb Johnston is doing a session tomorrow when? If you are interested in teaching the course and you want to hear a little bit more about the ins and outs of the classroom practice, Deb is one of the first teachers to teach the course. She's one of the best people to teach the course, and she's also just a lovely human being. So I highly recommend going to see her course. And second, we're having cocktails. I didn't think I was going to need an hour and a half, but it turns out we did. So,
wine and beer.
Wine and beer, no cocktails. We are really cheap. We should have sprung for hard liquor. All right, not for you guys. You guys can't. Oh wait, we're in Europe. They might be allowed to do that. All right, sorry. Okay. Anyway, thank you all very much. If you want to get in touch with me, this is my email. I didn't put my cell phone on here because I don't know if it would work, and that'd be expensive. It's easier to just reach out via email. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.